Hear the word of the Lord from Amos. Several passages crystallize and capsulize the meaning of his dynamic preaching to Israel at a time of apostasy, opulence, and materialism. Hear the word of the Lord. Hear this word that the Lord has spoken against you, O children of Israel, against the whole family which I brought up from the land of Egypt, saying, you only have I known of the families of the earth. Therefore I will punish you for all your iniquities. And then from the fifth chapter, beginning at the 22nd verse, though you offer me burnt offerings and your grain offerings, I will not accept them. Nor will I regard your fattened peace offerings. Take away from me the noise of your songs, for I will not hear the melody of your stringed instruments, but let justice roll like water and righteousness like a mighty stream. And then from the seventh chapter of Amos, beginning in the seventh verse through the ninth verse, thus he showed me, behold, the Lord stood on a wall made with a plumb line, in his hand. And the Lord said to me, Amos, what do you see? And he said, a plumb line. Then the Lord said, behold, I am setting a plumb line in the midst of my people Israel, and I will not pass by them anymore. The high places of Isaac shall be desolate, and the sanctuaries of Israel shall be laid waste. I will raise up a sword against the house of Jeroboam. May God add his blessing to this reading from his word, and to him be glory and honor. Let us pray. Gracious Lord, you unsettle us with your truth. We thank you that you are an objective standard in the midst of the sloppy subjectivism of our confused thinking and our equivocation. We thank you that you give us a firm edge on which to cut so that we can know who we are, whose we are, and for what we were intended. Bless us, Lord. We need your fatherly care that loves us enough to hold us accountable, to call us to obedience, to help us when we fail, and to give us a new beginning. In the name of Christ Jesus, who died that that might be possible, and rose from the dead for us to know that you give us victory in life's struggles. In his name, we humbly pray. Amen. Jimmy MacDonald, the wonderful black preacher and singer, has taught me a lot about black worship and told me what I'm denied in my congregation. He said, Lloyd, you don't get much response from your people. He said, why, when I preach, when I start out, they say, amen. And then when I get rolling a little bit, they say, well. And then when I really start to step on their toes, they say, help him, Lord, help him. Well, if you see that I'm standing pigeon-toed, it's because I'm standing on my own toes. I feel that's appropriate that I step on my own toes before I step on yours, because I believe that preaching often involves that. When the power of the word of the Lord takes a preacher by the scruff of the neck and the Lord puts a warrant in his soul and he must speak the word that God has given him, he better be quite sure that he stepped on his own toes before he steps on anyone else's. Recently, I talked to two men. What they said was so different that it amazed me. One of them said that he had been a part of a church that he never heard the love of God. Can you imagine that? Judgment every Sunday, fire and brimstone. He said, I really knew it was a great service when I felt guilty. I'd go out of church and I'd say to the pastor, I feel so bad. And the pastor would say, "Wonderful, the word of God's getting after you." Well, that man left the church at a very important period of his life and hasn't been back since. He's a distinguished businessman in America, and he has nothing to do with the church or the gospel or religious people simply because all he ever got was negative judgment and put down. I talked to another man whose story was quite a contrast to that. He said, "I was a part of a church where they talked about the love of God all the time. Love and acceptance and affirmation and forgiveness. It was wonderful, kind of oozy and ozzy. You know, you came to church and you just felt so good when you left, and you knew that it didn't make anything, any difference what you did, with whom you did it, or how you did it, or when you did it. It was just all right. God was smiling, and every time I did something wrong, he said, I'd look up to heaven, and there was God saying, it's okay, don't you worry about it at all. It's just, you just go ahead. It's going to ruin your life, and you'll probably die from it, but just go right ahead. It's okay. He said, I never had a sharp edge to cut in. There was nothing. No objective standard. Everything was just sloppy, agape. Yeah. And we wonder, which of those two churches is right? Which one would you like to go to? You wonder, would you like to be at a church where all they ever did was make you feel bad? Or would you like to be at a church where always they made you feel good, even when you weren't? We wonder. What we need to do is put them both together. Because both aspects are a part of the heart of God, both parts of what it means to be a father. The minor prophets are a clarion call back to the father heart of God. During these next weeks, we're going to be talking about what God said through his prophets to bring his people back to his fatherly heart. Now, it's the task of a father to set standards, to help children be all that they were meant to be, help them deal with their failures, and then be a part of their beginning again. I believe that the great need in America today is to return to the Father heart of God. We've been walking in the garden alone with Jesus and have forgotten that Jesus came to lead us back to the Father heart of God. Some of us have had the private esoteric experience of the Spirit unrelated to the necessity of obedience to the Father and have forgotten that the Spirit works in us in order to lift us back to the sovereign God who makes demands upon us and makes us accountable for the way we use our life and our world. I believe that some of the psychological sickness of our time is that we're all in search of Father. We've missed him. There's been no toughness, no edge to catch, cut upon, nothing that's objective. It's all our feeling. If you feel well someday, God's in his heaven. If you don't feel well, somehow he's abdicated for that day. What a tragic kind of life to live. You feel like a yo-yo going up and down and vacillating feelings. What we need is a father who says, this is who you are. This is what you were meant to be, and come. Let me take you in my everlasting arms and give you the courage to be the full manner of woman you were meant to be. There's a new wind blowing in America, and it's coming from a clarified declaration, not just of God whom we can put in our pocket, not just a God who meets our needs, but God who is sovereign and king and Lord. And when we give our lives to him, he calls for accountability. It goes in a cycle, and don't miss it. When you love him, you want to serve him with obedience. And it's obedience that is the secret of spiritual knowledge. It's when you say yes, Lord, to his commandments, to the life he revealed to us in Jesus Christ, to the Sermon on the Mount, to the admonitions of the Lord, and then to the infilling power of his Spirit. They all work together. But it's when we say, yes, I will obey, that then we know God more deeply and more intimately and more powerfully than ever before. If you're feeling that God is aloof and you don't know him personally and you'd love to receive his power, then ask him for a specific direction. Give your life to him. Live it out to the fullest this next week, and you'll know him better, because you'll know more of yourself to give to more of him, and the relationship will begin to grow. Wonderful story of Lloyd Douglas, you know, the physician and author. He went up the stairs of a cold water flat, and there he met a little craftsman working on a violin. And this little man said nothing as Lloyd Douglas walked into his workshop. Douglas said, "How are you? What is the good news today?" Man still said nothing. He put down his tools, got up from his little bench, walked over to the tuning fork, took a hammer, and gave it a smart blow. Boom. And he struck A. And he said, "Do you want to know what the good news is? It was A yesterday, it was A 100 years ago, it's A today, and it's going to be A tomorrow, and it'll be A 100 years from now, and A at the end of the world." I believe that's what we need when we come to worship. I think that's what we need when we begin to study the scriptures or pray our prayers. We need to come back to something that's objective. The world has all of its confusing, sloppy, subjective feelings about what is right and wrong. Eventually, we need a God who holds us accountable and says, "That's wrong and that's right, and do this and dare to do that." And then the power of the Spirit comes and enables us to do that. And that's when the victorious life comes to be possible. Only a sinner needs a Savior. Only one who feels his need opens his heart to God. Over and over again, we ask people to send their needs. You've expressed your needs over and over again. We've built our messages on them. But beyond meeting our needs is being obedient to the living God to do however much we know that he has told us to do. Amos began a ministry in Israel at a crucial time. He came from the southern kingdom. He lived in the area of the wilderness of Tekoa, about 12 miles south of Jerusalem. And there in the rugged, craggy desert, a warrant was placed in his soul to preach the truth of the living God. He strode all the way up to Jerusalem and then beyond, up to Bethel, which was the place where the king lived, Jeroboam II, about the year 750 BC. And there he saw the worship of the people of God. He saw the irrelevancy of what they worshiped and what they believed to the life that they were living. There was slavery, materialism, idolatry, resistance against God. The family of God was wrought asunder with mutual judgment and conniving. Dishonesty was on the marketplace. And as a result, the Lord called Amos a shepherd, a grower of sycamore, and called him to preach the word of the Lord. And then he gave him a vision, a marvelous vision, along with others. It was a vision of a plumb line. And he saw the Lord standing on a wall with a plumb line in his hand. And he lowered the plumb line down on the wall, and he said, "Amos, what do you see?" And Amos said, "Well, it's the plumb line, Lord." And then the Lord declared that with that plumb line, he was going to judge the house of Israel. Now, we all know that it's with a plumb line that you determine the perpendicular in relation to the horizon. It's interesting also to note that the word predestined in Greek means that which is fore-horizoned. God had us in mind. He called us and chose us, made us a part of his people, and he built us up with the plumb, made us to be a strong and resolute wall. The problem in Israel was that there was a terrible dichotomy between essentials. Jesus said, "What God has joined together, let no man put asunder." And the problem in Israel was that they had wrought asunder things which God had put together. Consider these, for example. Number one, being blessed and being a blessing. The Lord said in the second verse of the third chapter of Amos, listen to these words, "You only of all the families of the earth have I loved. Therefore, I will punish your iniquity." A part of the love of God is that he calls us and he blesses us and he punishes iniquity. Now, the meaning of the Hebrew word iniquity is any kind of a habitual pattern of resistance and rebellion. It's because the Lord blesses us that he judges us. I remember listening to two young people talking. One had to go home, and he said, "Gee, I've got to go home. My dad demands that I be home." And as he walked out of the restaurant, the other said to another friend, "Gee, I wish I had a dad who made some kind of demands on me." There are lots of people crying out for a heavenly father like that, who makes some demands because we're blessed to be a blessing. The second dichotomy that existed in Israel at that time was a division between the worship of God and the knowledge of God. Could it possibly be true? Yes, it happened in Israel at that period, prior to the exile, that the people had divided their worship of God from the knowledge and the presence of God. Someone once said that there is no greater defense against God than religion. It's true. You can worship God, develop your phrases and worship programs and work in the committees of the church and give your money and develop your life and try and be right with God on your own strength rather than trusting him. And the result is that the very worship, the very activity for God holds God at arm's length. And what he does is cut with his sword right through our religious piousity, all of our phrases, all of our own self-generated goodness, and he splits us open and says, "This is who you are. But I love you still." Another dichotomy that existed in Israel was the knowledge of God and making God known. The tragedy was that the people of God who had been called to be his people were not a channel of his grace to other people. They expanded their borders and possessed land, often by battle and dishonest means, without caring about the people, realizing that God had communicated his grace to them so that they could love the world. That judgment is upon America, for we've been called by God to exemplify in history what it means to be a nation under God. The sword of the Lord is upon us. We question, to what extent are our lives channels of communication for his grace? How many people in your life do not know the Savior? The Lord may have put you in touch with that person for no other reason than for the purpose that you might love that person, listen to him or her, care, so that eventually you might have the opportunity to share what Christ means to you and to help them into new life. You cannot sever knowing God and making him known. But lastly, a terrible dichotomy was that they separated the sacred from the secular, a holy God from holy living. Jesus constantly put an emphasis on being and doing in response to him. Any belief which is not put into action putrefies in a kind of sterile piety in our being and will separate us from God rather than help us to know God. I talked to a surgeon one day. I said, "Is it ever hard for you to operate on someone you know and love?" He said, "Oh, yes. But when they're out on the operating table and I realize that inside of their body is a malignancy that must come out if they're going to live, I lift up the scalpel and I cut deep because I love them." And that's what the Lord does for us. He cuts into the malignancy of our life, opens us up, and takes out of us anything that would separate us from him. Judgment is a part of love. He is our Father, and he calls us home to his heart and is waiting to receive us and love us and forgive us. And that's the meaning of the cross. Calvary was when the judgment of God upon sin was blended with the forgiveness of God in the grace of the blood of Jesus Christ. And there, once and for all, he died to set us free.